According to the principle of general covariance, we have to write all the laws of physics in a general covariant way. This means that they are form invariant when we perform a general coordinate transformation. Form invariant or covariant means that they have exactly the same form in all reference frames, and this means that they have the same form for all observers. A second requirement that we will use later of the principle of general covariance is that these laws of physics must reduce to the special relativistic laws when we replace a general metric by the Minkowski space-time metric. So now the task that we have in front of us is to construct these laws of physics, which are general covariant, and in particular to find a general covariant law for gravity. This law, which will be expressed as the Einstein equations, will define a theory which is general relativity. However, instead of trying to find the equations of motion of fields and particles and so on, it is much better to construct actions from which one can derive the equations of motion. I don't remember if I mentioned this, but in general, it is not possible to find an action from which one can derive a certain equations of motion. You could think that this is a problem of the principle of least action approach, because you may like certain equations and you cannot derive them from an action, so, well, maybe these actions are not so good. But the truth is that when you cannot derive some equations of motion from an action, there is usually a consistency problem with them. Einstein himself, before he found the right equations for the gravitational field, wrote some equations which were not consistent. However, Hilbert used an action which is now called the Einstein-Hilbert action, from which he got the Einstein equation right from the beginning. And the difference between these two approaches is that there are certain consistency conditions of the equations of motion that, for instance, are related to the existence of symmetries, which are difficult to take into account when you just look at the equations of motion. However, these consistency conditions are satisfied automatically when you derive the equations of motion from an action that has the symmetry properties that you want. So the focus will be on constructing actions that have the right symmetries or that have the right invariances. This is exactly the same thing. The invariances that we are after are the invariants under general coordinate transformations that we also call diffeomorphisms. Another word for these objects in general, not just actions, that are invariant under general coordinate transformations or diffeomorphisms, is diff invariant objects. So this is what we are going to do now. The setup of this problem is very simple. All actions for a field theories in four dimensions will be volume integrals of some Lagrangian density. There might be some proportionality constant here that we may or may not include in the Lagrangian density, and that takes into account coupling constants and other issues, normalization and so on. But they are all of this form. Now, one thing that we found in the last lecture, lecture 3, was that this volume element d4x is only invariant under Poincaré transformations, but not under general coordinate transformations. And the way to make it invariant was to multiply it by the square root of the determinant of the metric. So we can write the same action in this way. Since now this volume element here, the combination of d4x square root of g, is now invariant, the whole problem reduces to finding objects which we will identify as the Lagrangian density divided by square root of g, which are invariant under general coordinate transformations, so which are general scalars. That's all that we have to do. And of course, when we discussed how to construct actions in the special relativistic case, we discussed that we needed kinetic terms with derivatives and so on. But here the problem, in a sense, is a bit simpler, because one of the requirements of the principle of general covariance is that this action reduces to the special relativistic one when the metric becomes is replaced by the Minkowski metric. More or less, you see that this is the case if this L is the Lagrangian of a special relativistic theory. So you could say, okay, one way, in general, this L is something that depends on fields, the derivatives of the fields, and if it is a special relativistic theory, it will depend on the metric, the Minkowski metric. And when I write this dependence, I am not meaning that the eta is a variable. It clearly is just a given metric, is the Minkowski metric. So it's not a variable, but the Lagrangian depends on it. Okay, it's part of this, as I could also add coupling constants and so on. So you could think that in order to make this covariant and also satisfy the requirement that when g is replaced by eta, then I recover this action, would be to replace eta by g everywhere. Okay, so if I replace eta by g, then it's clear that the requirement that when I replace g by eta, I recover this Lagrangian is satisfied. But this is a bit too simple, because we might be missing terms which should be present in the general covariant Lagrangian, which are zero for eta equal to the Minkowski metric. For instance, there could be a dependence on the Levi-Civita connection. Remember that this is given by the Christoffel symbols, and it has this form. Well, we have these three terms, and alpha come here. So this is mu nu, nu, mu, and mu nu. And it is evident that if I replace a general metric g by eta, these three derivatives vanish, and then the connection vanishes. So if there was some dependence on the connection in the general theory, then I would never obtain it by just replacing eta by g. Okay, because I would have zero somewhere, and I would have to replace that zero by gamma. So how can I find the places where this gamma may occur? Well, the connection appears mostly in covariant derivatives. Okay. So the idea is all that. okay, and these are. It is clear that they are covariant, while in general partial derivatives are not. So if I really replace these partial derivatives by covariant derivatives, I might be finding all the connections that are needed in order to make the Lagrangian really a scalar. So that is another thing that I will have to do. Another term that can appear and also vanishes for the Minkowski metric is the Riemann curvature tensor. Well, it may not appear just like this. It will appear maybe contracted with other objects and so on. And since this vanishes, I gave you a theorem that tells you that this exactly vanishes for when the metric is equal to eta, and vice versa, when it vanishes, the metric is equal to eta, at least in some region of spacetime. Then I really don't know where I should include this curvature tensor, because again, I could be replacing zero somewhere by terms with the curvature. However, remember that this object is depends on derivatives of gamma and terms quadratic on gamma, which just means that you have second derivatives of g, and also terms with one derivative of g squared. Then there are two possibilities. Either this term appears alone somehow, and then it gives me a dynamical term, a kinetic term for g, and then this gives me really a theory of gravity, and this is something that we'll have to study. Or I might be contracting this r with other terms that may also include derivatives. For instance, I can invent several that have this property. So, for instance, this term does not vanish. Okay, remember that this is antisymmetric, this is antisymmetric. So, the contractions are well done, no problem. But this has a derivative in A, another derivative in A, second derivative, okay, or derivative of G squared. This term has four derivatives. And theories that have more than terms with more than two derivatives in general have pathologies that we are not going to discuss. In general, they are pathological and we will discard them. Okay, another example of a term that we could invent with the same properties is with the Ricci tensor contracted with something like this. In general, are going to have things like this. There might be a few exceptions. In which this is not the case, in which there are couplings of R to other terms and which do not give rise to terms of higher order in derivatives, but they are, they have to be discussed much more in detail, and they do not fit in this course, which is a basic course. For instance, the Brans-Dicke theories are of this kind, or half terms of this kind, and the interpretation is more complicated and so on. So, okay, in trying to find Lagrangians for theories that satisfy the principle of general covariance, we arrive to this prescription, which is the minimal coupling. It's called a minimal coupling prescription. Okay, I take a special relativistic Lagrangian, and I do these two things. I replace everywhere the Minkowski metric by a general metric, and I replace all partial derivatives by covariant derivatives. This takes into account additional terms of the connection that were not present in this theory. You could not see them. Okay. So these two things ensure that, as we are going to see in examples, that the new Lagrangian divided by the square root of g, okay, is general covariant. In fact, it's a scalar, transforms as a scalar. And secondly, that when I replace g back by eta, then this gamma becomes zero, and clearly covariant derivatives become partial derivatives, I recover a special relativistic theory, which is the second requirement of the principle of general covariance. Okay, so what we are going to do now is put this prescription in practice and see what kind of Lagrangians we find, and what are the new equations of motion, how we deal with them. Since we have not added terms with the curvature, we have not added any dynamical or kinetic term for the metric, and we will still be in a setup in which the metric is a background metric, some fixed metric that we include just like eta, but with different values. It doesn't have to be equivalent to eta in some coordinate system. It may, but it doesn't have to. We will call this a background metric or a background gravitational field, and what we are going to do now with this minimal coupling prescription is to construct theories which are general covariant and describe the coupling of or how other fields behave in some non-trivial gravitational field which is fixed. Okay. The second step that we will take later on is to add a dynamical term for gravity, and then in this way we will construct the full theory of general relativity. Well, I forgot to say, but it was clear from this description that I have to modify this term. and write it like this, okay? And it's clear that to get back this volume integration element when you replace g by eta. So now let's consider a scalar field. Scalar field theory coupled to gravity or in a vacuum metric in this language. We know that the action, the special relativistic action, let me write phi and eta, although it is understood that eta is not really a variable, had this form. Okay, we wrote it in this form, which, and we make explicit the places where eta is, we have this eta mu nu partial mu phi partial nu phi. Okay, it's an inverse eta. Now, the principle of general covariance, or sorry, this minimal coupling prescription, which is an implementation of this principle, tells us that we have to replace d for x by d for x square root of g. This one half remains, and eta mu nu by the inverse metric g mu nu. Okay, and partial derivatives by covariant derivatives as well, but the partial the covariant derivative of a scalar is the partial derivative, so I can write partial derivatives or covariant derivatives, it is exactly the same. Now, in this context, you see that we are in it when you see this is the square root of g, we can write again d phi square. So if you look here and I say you see this d phi square, since there is no square root of g, you immediately realize that this d phi square includes eta. However, if you look here and you see a square root of g, you realize that this partial phi square includes this g mu nu instead of eta. Okay, so the action that we were looking for, and which clearly satisfies this principle of general covariance, has this form. Okay, and the next thing that we are going to do is to try to find the equations of motion that follow from the principle of least action applied to this action. The setup is always the same, and in particular you know that the variations of the field that we are going to consider around the classical solution will satisfy this boundary condition, that in the boundary of the four-manifold we are integrating over, these variations vanish. You could just apply the Euler-Lagrange equations, okay, taking into account that the only variable that we have here is phi, so there is only one equation, and this equation would be this one. Oops. Okay, but remember that here this is L, and this is includes this square root of g. So this is perfectly valid. Okay, when we found or we discussed the Euler-Lagrange equations, we never said what were the fields or the couplings that were inside. So, and we found this result in complete generality, as long as there are only two derivatives in the action. Otherwise, there are more terms. So this is something that you can do, and I encourage you to do it. It is also very simple to do, but just because we need some practice with these things, I am going to find the same equations by varying the action and imposing that it is the variation is zero for the classical solution. So I'm going to vary this. Okay. And then, I could vary a square root of g, but it is not a variable, it has a fixed value, some gravitational background. So the variation will be zero. I just don't vary it. Okay, I have one half. Again, I have here g mu nu, okay, but it is fixed, so I don't vary it. And then I have partial mu phi, partial mu phi, and I have to vary this, and I know that by symmetry I get a factor of 2 and just the variation of one of them, because mu nu is, this is symmetric in mu nu. Okay, so these two terms cancel. I know that this variation and the partial derivative commute, because this variation only acts on the field. And then this gives me partial mu delta phi, and the next thing I have to do is to integrate by parts to write everything in terms proportional to delta phi and not to the derivatives of delta phi. So I integrate by parts, but I have to take into account that I pick this square root of g inside of the derivative when I do it, and also g mu nu, and the thing that remains is this and delta phi, everything inside of the derivative, and minus everything but delta phi. Okay. Now I have to integrate this. This I can integrate immediately. It's a total derivative. Okay, according to general results, this will give me the integral over the boundary of this term here. Before I write exactly what it is, I prefer to write this in a covariant way. Okay, using this relation that is true for the Levi-Civita connection. Okay, this means that if I have this divergence, this d mu of something that has a mu index, then okay, this will come multiplying here. I have a mu, and then everything but the square root. So I get mu nu, partial nu phi, and delta phi. Okay, which I can also write in as this can be replaced by the mu phi if I want. Okay, I can do the same here with this term. Okay, and then I get mu d mu phi delta phi. Okay, then I can apply now the Gauss theorem in this language, and I know that this will give me, these are integrals over m. I don't want to write it all the time, but now when I apply the Gauss theorem, I get the integral over the boundary of this surface element. Okay, and this is the volume, if you want, of this three-dimensional hypersurface times a unit vector normal to the hypersurface. We have discussed this, and multiplying what you have inside. The other term. Okay, let me put it like this, plus, this is still this volume term, and it's minus, and you know that this partial derivative is just nabla mu, so one possible way of writing this is nabla squared phi delta phi. Okay, and clearly we have to evaluate this, the integrand, over the boundary. The boundary conditions are that delta phi over the boundary is 0. So this term will not contribute. And then we can identify this piece as the first variation of the action with respect to phi. Just by definition, it's the coefficient of delta phi. And the conclusion is that the action is extremized when this first variation, which is minus nabla squared. Okay, sometimes this is written as box phi, vanishes, and these are the classical equations of the scalar field in a gravitational background. The coupling is built inside of this nabla square. See, the first derivative does not have a metric, although you need a metric to raise this index here, this mu. But then the second derivative is just the derivative of contravariant vector, and you need a connection term. Okay, and this connection term can be written in a special way with the square root of g and so on, but this represents really the coupling of the metric, of this background metric, to the scalar, and it modifies this, the equation that you have in Minkowski spacetime, okay, due to this coupling. One remark is that I can add to any action, just like the action of this scalar, a total derivative. A total derivative, without modifying the equations of motion, a total derivative has this form, okay, a divergence, and I can write it in a covariant language by multiplying and dividing by square root of g. Okay, now you compare with the formulas that we have for the covariant divergence, and you see that this is the for x square root of g nabla mu p mu divided by square root of g. Okay, since this term, whatever term I add to my action or to my Lagrangian, has to be invariant, this means that b mu over square root of g has to transform as a contravariant vector, and this means that b mu is has to be a tensor density, a contravariant vector density. Otherwise, when you divide by the square root of g, you wouldn't have really a vector. Adding something like this does not modify the equations of motion because, well, we just studied this in the case of field theory in Minkowski spacetime, but the fact that this was Minkowski spacetime or not didn't play any role, just like it didn't play any role to determine that the equations of motion are this. Okay. By the way, from this using the Euler-Lagrange equations, since this Lagrangian does not depend on phi, this drops, and you have minus partial mu. This derivative gives you a factor of 2 that cancels 1/2, and then you have partial mu square root of g and g mu nu partial nu phi. Okay, equal to 0 as equations of motion, which reminds me that I have, in spite of everything that I have said, I have forgotten, well, let me do it. I have forgotten my square root of g term, so let me fix this error now. So this is what you get, and yeah, the coefficient of delta phi includes everything. So you have minus square root of g and minus square root of g. Okay, now it is completely correct. Well, we could add scalar potential to this action, so we would modify the action adding some delta s term of this form. And it is clear that this term should be modified just by adding the square root of g to make it general covariant. Okay, v of phi is a scalar, so you don't only need to covariantize d for x. As for the equation of motion, this term only contributes to this piece here. It doesn't depend on derivatives of phi, so it only depends on a derivative of phi, and what you get is an additional term in delta s delta phi, which is, oh my, which is minus square root of g, and then you have nabla squared phi plus v prime of phi. Okay, where v prime of phi is just the derivative with respect to phi of v. And this would be the new equations of motion where you have this term. The next example that we are going to consider is that of the electromagnetic field. We wrote the action in Minkowski space for the special relativistic theory, and it had this form. Now we have to make explicit all the occurrences of the Minkowski metric. So and remember that this field is defined with indices down. There is really a difference between one and the other, okay? Because when you raise the indices, you include factors of the metric, and in this case, when they are defined like this with indices down, this variable does not include the metric. The metric is included, okay, like this, either to raise indices or to contract indices, however you want to see it. Write it like this. It's f menu f alpha beta. Okay, so I apply this prescription, and I get this action. So first of all, I replace d4x by d4x times square root of g. The factor, the numerical factor, stays, and then I replace the metric by a general metric. Okay, and just as in the Minkowski case, I can use this metric to raise the indices of this or the other tensor, and again, in this context, there is no ambiguity concerning what we mean by f mu nu with indices up. Okay, the indices have been raised using the metric, because you see the metric here. And we can also write this in a more compact way. As f squared. And again, it is clearly understood that f squared means this, which in its turn means this. So the metric is included there. How about f mu nu itself? I haven't modified f mu nu. Why? Because, well, f mu nu was defined as partial mu a nu antisymmetrized and with a factor of 2. So this is partial mu a nu minus partial nu a mu. Applying this minimal coupling procedure, prescription, I would replace this by the covariant derivative. But then something funny happens. If I expand this covariant derivative, I know that this is partial mu a nu. Okay, before I antisymmetrize, I write the expression. This is gamma mu nu rho a rho. And now I antisymmetrize, but I know that the symmetric part of this connection is zero, because I am always using the Relativity connection. So f mu nu is not modified. You can check that the Bianchi identity is not modified either. You can write it with covariant derivatives if you want to, but the result is the expression is completely equivalent. If you write nabla mu f nu rho, again, before I antisymmetrize, I write this expression. I expand the covariant derivative, I mean. So this is mu nu sigma f sigma rho minus gamma mu rho sigma f nu sigma. Now I antisymmetrize everything, So in mu, nu, and rho. So since sigma is in the middle, I write it like this. And then you have mu, rho, and sigma. Okay, I don't need a bar here. Okay, and this is, means that this is fully anti-symmetrized in mu, nu, and rho, but okay, gamma is symmetric, so this term will vanish. And here it is the same. This is completely anti-symmetric in mu, rho, and nu, which means that in particular it is anti-symmetric in mu and rho, so this also vanishes. And the Bianchetti entity takes the same form. It is exactly the same with or without covariant derivatives. Okay, now the next thing that we have to do is to find the Maxwell equations. Again, we could have we could use directly the Euler-Lagrange equations, but we are going to vary the action because we prefer this as a training for you. And okay, the square root of g is not varied because it is a background metric. The numerical factor stays there. And now the metric stays there also. So I think the only thing that I'm going to get mu alpha and mu beta is a factor of 2 because I can either vary f mu nu or f alpha beta and really I get the same. Okay. So I get a factor of 2. You can do it, okay. So this would be the variation of f mu nu times f alpha beta. And f mu nu, the variation of alpha beta, and then you will see that because this thing is symmetric under the simultaneous interchange of mu nu and alpha beta, you get exactly the same. Okay, if I write it like this, I can use the metric to raise the indices of f alpha beta. So this would be delta f mu nu. F mu nu, and now I use the definition of f mu nu. Remember that it is 2 times the partial derivative of a nu. This delta commutes with the partial derivative, so it's just partial mu delta a nu. This in principle is anti-symmetrized. But because it is contracted with these 2 anti-symmetric indices, I can remove the anti-symmetrizer because this is automatically anti-symmetric, only the anti-symmetric part contributes. These 2 terms cancel. And the only thing that I have to do is to integrate by parts in order to rewrite this as a total derivative plus a term proportional to delta a nu. Now here, every time I integrate by parts, I pick a term with a factor of a square root of g. Well, it has minus sign, square root of g, delta a nu f mu nu. This is the total derivative, which will vanish because of the same arguments as usual, so we are going to eliminate it already. Plus a term that is the derivative of everything else. So it is, it contains f mu nu, and then delta a nu is outside. Okay, so automatically we have identified this as delta s delta a nu because it is the coefficient of delta a nu. And we can write these equations of motion, which are partial mu square root of g f mu nu. And then now, if you remember, one of the properties that we discussed, one of the properties of the Levi-Civita connection that we discussed, this, if we multiply and divide by square root of g, then all this is just the covariant divergence. So this is nothing but lambda mu f mu nu. And it is equal to 0. Okay, these are the equations, the Maxwell equations. And again, they have essentially the same form as in the special relativistic case. When g is eta, this is 1, and the covariant derivative reduces to the partial derivative, so you recover exactly what you expected. But when the metric is not the Minkowski metric, there are couplings, all sorts of couplings to the metric inside of the equations that reflect the fact that you are in a non-trivial gravitational background.